The somatic senses provide a way for us to know about our internal environment, our body surface, and what's in our immediate vicinity. Humans rely on their auditory and visual systems to make sense of cues that are in the distance, but in our immediate surroundings, right in our personal space, the somatosensory system plays a really important role. Well, what do I mean by the somatic senses? Well, this is a diverse set of sensations. It includes touch, pain, proprioception, that's how we know where our muscles and our limbs are, and also whether it's hot or cold. Based on your own experiences, you already know that the body is studded with sensory receptors. If I blindfolded you, and then I reached out and I moved your arm above your head, you'd know that I had done that. If I handed you a tennis ball, you'd know that it was round, you'd know the approximate size, you'd figure out that it's fuzzy, you'd probably know it was a tennis ball. And if I held an ice cube to your skin, you'd know that it was cold and smooth. Well, to draw these conclusions about environment, there must be sensory neurons. And that's what we're going to be looking at in this video, the peripheral receptors that make all this possible. It's a complicated system, so I'm going to focus just on the receptors that are found from the neck down. You've got a lot of somatosensory receptors in your head, but the pathways are a little bit different, and it's really beyond the scope of what I want to do in this video. This is also a good time to mention that in addition to our conscious awareness, the brain has unconscious pathways. For example, even when you're sitting or sleeping, you make small postural adjustments, but I won't be focusing on those systems. Okay, let's look at the players, beginning with the skin. In this medical illustration, the skin surface is at the top. We call this the epidermis. Lying underneath it is the dermis, and beneath that is the hypodermis, which has a lot of connective tissue and adipose tissue. Although we think about the skin as being composed of skin cells, in addition to those skin cells, there are also different types of sensory receptors. Many of these were first identified in the second half of the 19th century, starting around 1850, by Italian and German anatomists. They used the following approach. They would touch the surface of the skin with a fine brush, or with either a dull or sharpened wire, or with a thin copper cylinder that they had heated or cooled to a precise temperature. And what the anatomists found was that the human skin is a mosaic. We've got hot spots and cold spots and pain spots and itching spots. But each spot responds to only a single type of sensory information. The scientists then would do a biopsy and pull out the piece of tissue lying right underneath the spot to see if there were any specialized structure. And there were. Let me show you some of the structures they identified. Near the top surface, we have free nerve endings, as well as Merkel discs and Meissner corpuscles. A little deeper lie the Ruffini corpuscles, and even deeper, almost in the hypodermis, we have Pacinian corpuscles. There are also nerve endings that wrap around the base of hair follicles and that are stimulated when the hairs are deflected. I've now divided these receptors into two broad categories. On the left, we've got the free nerve endings. These are sensitive to temperature or to pain. The other group all have a specialized accessory structure along with the nerve cell proper. These are all mechanoreceptors, and they're looking for different qualities of touch. Finally, I should say that in addition to the receptors that are scattered in your skin, we've got lots of sensory receptors within other parts of our body. For example, in the figure I'm showing on the lower left, you can see that the tendons and the muscles have mechanoreceptors that will be stimulated if the muscle contracts and it moves the limb. All of these various somatosensory receptors share some common features, but there are also some differences. Let's look at these. Well, here's a cartoon that I've drawn, and it's showing you the first major similarity that all of these somatosensory neurons share, and that's that they all have cell bodies that are lying in a dorsal root ganglion, and they're all going to collect information from the periphery and then send that into the spinal cord. However, there are going to be differences in where in the spinal cord the information travels, and also how long it takes that information to get there. Let me walk you through this. Here I've drawn touch and pressure receptors. Now I'm using a Pacinian corpuscle for my cartoon, but remember this would include all of those different types of receptors in the skin, the Merkel discs, the Ruffini endings, those nerves that are wrapped around the hair cells. The bottom figure is showing you some of the receptors that are involved in proprioception, and here I'm illustrating what's called the muscle spindle receptor. So these are nerve fibers that are wrapped around the muscle and can sense stretch in the muscle, but again, there are other types of proprioceptors. All the touch and pressure receptors belong to what are called the A-beta class of neurons. These are about 10 microns in diameter, they're quite heavily myelinated, and that allows them to propagate action potentials pretty fast, between 35 and 75 meters per second. Proprioceptors are even bigger. They belong to what are called the A-alpha, also known as the 1A class of receptors, or sometimes the A-beta. It depends on what type you're looking at. These are large and heavily myelinated. They're the fastest of all the somatosensory receptors, and they can relay action potentials at 100 meters per second, or even faster. What this cartoon is showing you is both the pressure and the touch and the proprioceptors send their information into the dorsal horn. There, a collateral branch of the axon can make synapses in the dorsal horn itself. For simplicity, I'm not going to show you these pathways, but you should know that there are a number of reflexes that can be initiated by this branch. But the axons also turn and enter the dorsal column. They'll project up to the brainstem, traveling in what's called the dorsal column medial lemniscus pathway. On the other side of the figure, I've drawn two different types of receptors. Here, in purple, we've got a group of neurons that respond to sharp pricking pain and cold temperature. These nerve cells belong to a different class. They belong to what's called the A-delta class of axons. They might only be 1 to 5 microns in diameter, so smaller, and although they're myelinated, the myelin sheath is not as thick as for the touch receptors. The last class of receptors are shown in red. Neurons with this morphology respond to dull, itching pain, as well as to hot temperatures. They belong to the C class of receptor, and they're the smallest. Sometimes they're less than a micron in diameter, and they're not myelinated at all, which means that they're very slow. The action potentials in these neurons might propagate at 1, maybe 2 meters a second, so the information being detected by this class of receptor will take the longest to reach the brain. Both of these smaller classes of neurons that I've illustrated on the left side enter the spinal cord and make synapses onto interneurons in the dorsal horn. These are projection interneurons. They will cross the midline and enter what's called the anterolateral tract, and from there ascend to the thalamus in what's called the spinothalamic pathway. I'm going to leave the details of these ascending pathways for another day. Now, one of the things that you might be wondering is, why are there so many different types of mechanoreceptors? And this gives me a chance to talk a little bit about some properties of sensory receptors. The first thing I want to tell you about is this concept called the receptive field. Receptive field is basically the part of the environment that will elicit a response in the sensory neuron. In the case of touch receptors, it is literally what part of the body needs to be touched in order for that cell to fire action potentials. This picture shows you the sizes of receptor cells for the various types of touch receptors. The top row showing us Meissner corpuscles and Merkel discs. These were the type of receptors that were close to the surface, and they tend to have small receptive fields. Each one of those red dots represents a different corpuscle. The bottom row is showing us Pacinian corpuscles and Ruffini corpuscles. These lie deeper, and they have much larger receptive fields. For example, look at this Pacinian corpuscle here. The cell body, the structure itself, is lying right where that dot is, where the arrow is pointing, but that single neuron will respond if any of the yellow area is touched. The neurons that have the smallest receptive fields are also found in the greatest numbers. We have about 17,000 receptors in each of our hands, and the vast majority of these are Meissner and Merkel corpuscles. You can also see that there's a spatial difference. The density is greatest in the fingertips. We might have 140 Meissner corpuscles per square centimeter in our fingertip, but only 20 Pacinian corpuscles. Another property that distinguishes different types of receptors is the rate of adaptation. That's how long a receptor will respond to a stimulus. So what's done to determine this is that you record from the neuron while applying a mechanical stimulus. So you might push down on the skin here, hold it, and then release it here. And the whole time we'd be counting how many action potentials are being fired. And what I want you to notice is that the Meissner's corpuscles and the Pacinian corpuscles, those that are on the left-hand column, have what's called a phasic response. They fire at the start of the stimulus and at the end, but even though the push is being sustained, they don't fire in the middle. In contrast, the Merkel discs and the Ruffini corpuscles fire as long as there's a stimulus. We call these tonic receptors. It would be convenient for neuroscience students if there was just a single type of receptor, But the reality is that there is no way to make a sensory neuron detect all different kinds of stimuli. Your brain needs to have different kinds of receptors in order to make sense of the environment. We break up the range of possible stimuli with different types of receptors that are specialized to respond to just one aspect of external stimuli. I want to give you a practical illustration of how these different types of mechanosensory receptors can be activated in a task. What I'm showing you here is a series of Braille characters. Now imagine that we run our finger along this in order to see the pattern of activity in the various touch receptors. What we see here are some differences. The Merkel discs would be quite useful for distinguishing the different patterns. They're really good at detecting fine, light touch. In contrast, the Pacinian corpuscles would be pretty useless in this task. The brain would know that there was some kind of texture, but nothing about the fine detail. In other situations, though, maybe something involving deep pressure or vibration, the Pacinian corpuscle might provide the most useful information. The concepts of receptive field and rate of adaptation can, and are, applied to other types of sensory receptors. Let me give you an example from thermoreception. Temperature-sensitive neurons. Well, in this figure, each line represents a different sensory receptor, and we're looking at the number of action potentials that are fired when it's stimulated at a variety of different temperatures. That's what the x-axis is. I'm just going to remind you that the normal body temperature of mammals is 37 degrees, and our skin surface is only 1 or 2 degrees cooler. So what that means is that all of the receptors, all of the lines for sensory neurons that have their peak over in this area, are sensitive to cold, while the neurons that have the highest number of action potentials in the hotter temperatures are serving as heat receptors. You might wonder how it is that we're able to detect different temperatures. The answer, at a cellular level, is that there's a family of temperature-sensitive membrane proteins called the TRP family of ion channels. There are several different types of them, and different types are activated by different temperatures. Many of these channels can also be activated when they bind botanical substances. So, for example, hot peppers can bind to the TRPV1 protein, activating it, and we perceive food with this compound in it as hot, even if it's served at room temperature. Similarly, mint can activate sensory neurons containing the TRPM8 channel, and we perceive mint as cooling. Returning to the concept of receptive fields, neurons that have different receptive fields, say for a hot-sensitive versus a cold-sensitive neurons, will have different TRP proteins in their membranes. So for example, here's a neuron that has a peak around 42 degrees, and this neuron is likely to be expressing the TRPV1 type of channel, or maybe the TRPV2. In contrast, here's a neuron that has the best response around 24 degrees. Presumably, it's expressing the TRPM8 or the TRPV4 channel in its membranes. I'm going to close by saying just a few words about pain receptors because I've found that students are sometimes surprised to learn that we have specific receptors for pain. But if you think about it, one of the most important things for an animal to know in order to survive and be successful is whether it's damaged its tissues. When tissue is damaged, a whole suite of signals are released. The nociceptors contain membrane receptors for a lot of these different signals. We're able to detect things like tissue acidosis. Is there an increase in the protons outside the cell? An increase in potassium. Remember that normally potassium levels are really low outside the cell, so it's unusual to find that. We're able to detect heat. Some pain receptors express TRP channels so that they can respond to extreme temperatures, hot or cold. And there are even receptors for specific proteins in neuroinflammatory hormones. Although there's a diverse set of signals, when the pain receptors send this information to the central nervous system and it reaches the brain, we perceive this. We make a construct of pain. Pain perception is a really fascinating area of research, and it's one that we don't fully understand. This is something that I think we'll learn a lot more about in coming years.